हाय गाइस, गुड मॉर्निंग, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। लक्की गोयल गुड मॉर्निंग, काजल गुड मॉर्निंग, परेश पवार गुड मॉर्निंग, गौरव गुड मॉर्निंग, रूपानंद गुड मॉर्निंग। हेलो गाइस, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। I hope your studies are going very good during this lockdown. Okay, so this is our day 4 session on business combination and consolidation, right? Anirudh, Akib, good morning guys. So this is our day 4 session. Tentatively it will take around 6 sessions. Not 5 sessions, it will take around 6 sessions, even around 6 sessions. I'll not say more than that, but around it will take 6 sessions. I'll try to cover up in 6 sessions only. Kapil Kumar, good morning. Karam, good morning. Akib, I'm fine. I'm now good. Now I'm absolutely fine. Okay, so can we start the session now? Can we start the session? Guys, till now, that means in these previous three classes, what we have already covered. Okay. Yes, Ankit, good morning. So guys, till now what we have already covered, please see this. This is the index. And what we have already covered. First, acquisition method we have covered. Four elements to solve the questions. Yes. Purchase consideration. What is purchase consideration? How it is calculated? We have already covered. About non-controlling interest, we have already read that. Goodwill or gain from bargain purchase, we have already covered. Revaluation of net assets. In the last class only, we have covered this. Treatment of dividend. Yes, again in the last class. Okay, so till point number 7, serial number 7, from 1 to 7, we have covered these things. Now, our today's topic, Yash Modi is asking, sir, where is your beard? For that, you have to just watch the previous session. I explained that why my beard has been gone. So, for today's session, what we are going to discuss. Today we are going to discuss this unrealized profit loss elimination point, this multiple acquisition point, right? This unrealized profit loss, this multiple acquisition, okay? And if possible, we will discuss the disposal of shares. If possible, we will discuss the disposal of shares. So these three topics are going to be discussed in today's session. These three topics: unrealized profit loss elimination, multiple acquisition, that is step acquisition, which is very important topic, and the third one is disposal of shares. Okay, so now what? First of all, we shall start with this multiple acquisition or step acquisition. First of all, we shall start with this. So open up your page number 249. You guys haven't told me about my book, about these notes. You guys haven't given any kind of feedback on this notes and this book. I just want your feedback on this. So please guys, tell me your feedback. Yes, this is multiple acquisition. Multiple acquisition. Okay. Shall we start? Multiple acquisition. Multiple acquisition. Or we call it step acquisition. We call it step acquisition. See. Now guys, listen to me very carefully. This is a very important topic. So now see the points. Multiple acquisition. Guys, there can be two different scenarios. Under multiple acquisition, there can be two different scenarios. First, first time acquisition 60%, sorry, first time acquisition 40%, second time acquisition 30%. See, what do you mean by multiple acquisition? Basically, holding company or parent company has acquired the shares of subsidiary company in slots. Basically, has acquired the shares in different slots. So first time we acquired just 40% shares. And second time we acquired another 30% shares. In the second time. Now see the second situation. First time acquisition, 60% shares we acquired. And second time acquisition, we acquired 20%. Now, can you please guys tell me the difference between these two situations? Is there any kind of difference, or these are actually the different situations? Please tell me any kind of difference between these two situations. Yes guys, please tell me. Okay, tell me guys, I'm waiting. First case, control is acquired on second slot. Yes, very good, Anisha. Very good. in first situation there is associate relationship and in the second there is subsidiary relationship on the first acquisition. Okay, great. First case from associate it becomes subsidiary, in second case it is subsidiary from first acquisition. Different in first case condition for subsidiary. Okay, first case control transferred, second time acquisition. Okay, see guys, in the first case, in the very first case, we are assuming that the control is acquired only when we acquire more than 50% shares, right? So in this first case, yes, your answer is correct. In this first case, first of all, we became the second company became our subsidiary, our associate company, and in the second acquisition it became our subsidiary, right? So it is called step acquisition. Step acquisition, that means we acquired control on stepwise acquisition, on stepwise acquisition. This is called step acquisition. So control is obtained on the time of second acquisition. Control is obtained at the time of second acquisition, right? At the time of second acquisition. Understood or not? And here we can say control is already acquired at first acquisition. So control is acquired already at first acquisition. These two cases are different, and yes, there are different treatments. These two cases are different, and yes, there are different treatments for these two situations, right? Okay, everyone is answering in correct way. So both the situations are different situations, and we have to discuss all these two situations separately. So first situation, I'm discussing first situation. Situation one, that is, it is step acquisition. What do you mean by step acquisition? Control is obtained at the time of second or third acquisition. That means we already have some investments. We already have some investments in subsidiary company before acquiring control. Guys, this is very important point. We already have some investments in subsidiary company before acquiring control. So before acquiring control, you already have say 5%, you already have say 15% or 25% or 35%, 45%. You already have some sort of shares in the same company. Then again you acquired some more investments so that it becomes your subsidiary. Guys, understood or not? Okay, so you acquired the investments in parts and the control is being obtained after some point of time. At very first instance, the control is not obtained, right? So this is called step acquisition. This is called step acquisition. Now see the example. Please see this example. For example, this is the these are the two financial financial years, say 2021 and say 21-22. These are the two financial years. For example, on 1st April we acquired say 10% investment. 10% investment we acquired, right? We acquired 10% investment. At 1 lakh rupees. So tell me, in the books of investor company, I'm not say right now, I'm not say holding company, because we have acquired just 10%, so we cannot become holding by acquiring 10%. So in the books of investor company, say H Limited, what shall be the entry on 1st April 2020? I'm talking about SFS. Obviously, the entry should be investment account debit 1 lakh. To bank 1 lakh. Guys, understood or not? And this is how much percentage? 10%. It is neither my associate company nor my joint venture. And it is not at all my subsidiary company also. So obviously, Ind AS 27 would not be applicable. Guys, understood or not? Investment account debit to bank. But Ind AS 27 would not be applicable. So which Ind AS I should apply? Obviously, I can apply Ind AS 109 for the subsequent measurement of this investment on my balance sheet date. Guys, understood or not? On my balance sheet date, I have to apply Ind AS 109, fair value through P&L or fair value through OCI. I have to apply Ind AS 109 for the measurement. Okay, have you understood this point? Please tell me. Anirudh, very good. Okay, so books of the investor on 1/4/20. Understood? Ind AS 109 on balance sheet date. Okay. Now, suppose on 1st of July, again we have acquired 60%. We acquired 60% investments at 7,50,000. Now tell me, earlier we acquired 10%, now we acquired 60%, whether we got the control or not. Yes, we got the control at the time of second acquisition. Here we can say investor company becomes holding company. Now, since it has obtained the control, now
So now, can you please tell me what should be the date of acquisition?
Now, please, date of acquisition. See, day one session. In the day one session only, we understood that the date of acquisition is very important factor. The relevance of this date is very important because on this date, we actually calculate four basic elements. The purchase consideration, the 100% net assets fair value, the NCI fair value, and obviously the goodwill or capital reserve. That means gain from bargain purchase. So on which date we actually require to calculate all these things? On date of acquisition. So can you guys please tell me what should be the date of acquisition? Is it 1/4/2020 or 1st July 2021? Please tell me 1st July or 1/4. Yes, you guys are correct. Obviously, the date of acquisition would be 1st July 2021. 1st July 2021. Understood or not? 1st July 2021. So, Ind AS 103 and 110 would not be applicable. In financial year 2021. This is the financial year 2021. In this financial year, 103 and 110 would not be applicable because there is not a relationship of subsidiary company. We haven't acquired the business because under business combination, the business must be acquired. Oh my God. Guys, actually, the electricity has been gone. So, let me check the status first of all because electricity has been gone. क्या करें, लाइट चली गई. वेट कर लेते थोड़ा सा. गाइस एक्चुअली लाइट्स हैज बीन गॉन, सो वी जस्ट नीड टू वेट फॉर 5 मिनट्स. इफ इन 5 मिनट्स और द लाइट हैज कम, देन ऑब्वियसली वील कंटिन्यू. ओके, so sorry for the inconvenience guys, really sorry for the inconvenience, but I can't do anything. I have the backup, but I'm sure that it will not last for more than 15 to 20 minutes. So we just have to wait. So I'm changing the screen. Right, I am changing the screen and we are waiting for 5 minutes or 5 to 7 minutes. If the light will come, electricity will come, then we will continue. Otherwise, we will postpone this session. We will postpone this session in today's date only. Don't worry, in today's date only, I'll take this session day 4. Don't worry guys, okay? Hello. Yes, guys, good news. Electricity has been come. So there is no worry now. Great. Electricity has come. So we were talking about, like, in the financial year 2021, Ind AS 103-110 would not be applicable, right? Because in the financial year 2021, there was just a 10% investment. We haven't acquired the control. We haven't acquired the business. We haven't acquired the control. We haven't acquired the business. Guys, understood or not? Okay. But in financial year 21-22, Ind AS 103-110 shall be applicable. Ind AS 110 and 103 shall be applicable with effect from 1st July 2021. And this is the very important point. With effect from 1st July 2021, Ind AS 103 and 110 would be applicable. Guys, understood or not? So, I'm just waiting for everyone to come up again. Susan Matthew, in yesterday class, can we take depreciation rate on revaluation amount to know additional depreciation? Not exactly, because yes, this is the alternative way, but ICAI doesn't follow it actually. Institute doesn't follow this alternative way to calculate the depreciation on revaluation amount directly. So I recommend you don't do this. This is a good approach, but don't do this because your answer may be different. Your answer may be different. Okay. Guys, please tell me, are you guys with me? Please comment that yes, you are listening to me and my voice is audible. Please tell me. Okay. So yes, very good. So guys, the most important point is 103 would not be applicable in the financial year 2021. In the financial year 21-22, Ind AS 103 and 110 shall be applicable. Guys, understood? And this is our date of acquisition. This is our date of acquisition. Guys, understood or not? Now see, what additional treatment we have to apply in case of step acquisition. So what additional treatment we have to apply? Please see this point. Yes, please see this point. Calculation of goodwill or gain from bargain purchase. Calculation of goodwill or gain from bargain purchase. This is basically our COC, cost of control. This calculation we have already understood since day one. So please see this calculation. Come to this calculation. Now see this. Cost of investments, fair value of consideration transferred. If we take our example where we have acquired 10% earlier and now on date of acquisition we acquired 60%. That cost of investment, that is 60% cost of investment. Our cost of investment was 7,50,000. Our cost of investment was 7,50,000. Guys, I'm talking about 60% only. because at the time of acquisition of control, we have invested in the 60% shares of subsidiary company at a cost of 7,50,000, and this becomes our purchase consideration. This becomes our purchase consideration, right? Now see this, add, since at the time we obtained control, at the time when we got, when we acquired 60% shares, we are already having earlier 10% shares. We are already having 10% shares, which we acquired earlier, if you remember. So we already having 10% shares. So in totality, we are having 70% shares now. We are having 70% shares now. So see this, fair value of previous equity interest in case of multiple acquisition. Basically, it is called step acquisition. It is called step acquisition. That is 10%. That is 10%. Now, I am just asking you one simple question. What amount do we need to write here? What amount do we need to write here? It is saying fair value of previous equity interest. Fair value of previous equity interest. Technically, sir, why we are adding it? Obviously, guys, we are having now 70% share capital shares, right? So we are having 70% equity interest. So this is in respect of 60%, and this should be in respect of 10%, which we have acquired earlier. So the my question is, at how much amount it should be written? It should be written at how much amount, right? It is saying fair value of previous equity. So tell me the answer, at how much value it should be entered. Tell me at how much value it should be entered. Fair value of date of acquisition date. Lucky, great. So how much amount? Fair value of 10% shares on date of acquisition, Kajal Gupta. Great. Anirudh Goyal, fair value. Vatika, fair value on date of acquisition. So I just need the amount, guys. Please tell me the amount. Susan Matthew, 125. Ankit Kabra, 125. Okay. Since value not given separately. Yes, very good. Kirandeep, 125. Lucky Goyal, 125. Anisha Ruth, fair value on date of acquisition. Very good, guys. See, if on date of acquisition, 60% acquired at 750, therefore 10% should have fair value of 750 divided by 60 into 10. What is this? 750, it should be 125. It should be 125. So at 125, we have to write here. Then add NCI as per the above two methods. That means fair value method or proportion of net asset method. Less identifiable net assets of acquiree at fair value on date of acquisition. That means 100% net assets, obviously at fair value. Then we will get our goodwill or gain from bargain purchase. So basically, what do you mean by step acquisition? Step acquisition means earlier you have acquired some investments in the subsidiary company, and now you are again acquiring the investments, and at this time you are getting the control. Okay, at this time you are getting the control, then you have to calculate the goodwill or capital reserve at this time only. So while calculating goodwill or capital reserve, what you need to do, the previous equity interest shall be fair valued. The previous equity interest shall be measured at current date fair value. The previous equity investment shall be measured at fair value at current date of acquisition. Guys, understood or not? So this is basically called multiple acquisition. This is basically called multiple acquisition or step acquisition. Step acquisition or multiple acquisition. Guys, understood or not? Now come to that example once again. Come to that example once again. Yes, come to this example. Tell me, on 1/7/2021, again the entry in SFS of investor or holding company, the entry should be again investment account debit. Investment account debit 7,50,000 to bank account. 7,50,000 to bank account. Guys, tell me, is it clear or not? 7,50,000. Tell me, guys, is it clear or not? Is it clear or not? Okay, and suppose on date of acquisition, net assets 100%, fair value is 9 lakh, NCI is 270. NCI is 270. Okay, so in the books of investor SFS, this entry would be passed by for acquiring another 60% investment account debit 7,50,000 to bank 750. Guys, understood or not? Now total investment carrying amount will be 8,50,000. How? This 1 lakh and this 750, it will be 8,50,000. Total investment carrying amount in SFS. In SFS, total investment under SFS will be 850. You guys understood? Now it can be more than 850 also, because for the earlier investment of this 10%, we have to apply Ind AS 109. So on the balance sheet date, we can measure it as fair value. Might be the fair value is 1,10,000, 1,15,000. So it can be more than 850 also. But I am assuming that I haven't measured it at fair value, and my fair value was 1 lakh only. Again, okay. So it may be more than 850, obviously. But I am just assuming that it is already carried at fair value. Okay. So in my SFS, it is carried at 850. Guys, understood or not? So tell me, journal entry for consolidation on 1st July 2021, tell me journal entry for consolidation. I am waiting for your reply. I am waiting for your reply. Tell me journal entry for consolidation. Journal entry for consolidation. Please tell me. Nobody is replying. Strange. Still nobody is replying. Investment derecognized and total 70% PC is recorded and difference transfer to P&L. Okay. Susan Matthew, net asset debit 9 lakh. Not getting more replies, guys. Net assets debit 9 lakh. Okay, so sir, next. Net asset debit to investment to NCI along with investment gain. Net asset debit and investment credit. That's it. Kirandeep. Okay. See. Since I have told you that at the time of date of acquisition and at the time of calculating goodwill or capital gain from bargain purchase, we have to consider the fair value of previous equity. And our fair value of previous equity was 1,25,000. So what you need to do is, first of all, I have to make the fair valuation of previous equity. So first entry would be investment account debit 25,000. To P&L account 25,000, and then the second entry for consolidation. The second entry for consolidation would be net assets account debit 9 lakh to investments account. It would be 750, if you remember, the current investment plus 125 now. It becomes 125, na? Because earlier it was at 1 lakh. And we have increased it by 25,000. So now it is, this is fair value of previous equity to NCI. 2,70,000. Understood, guys? So 9 lakh minus 750, 125, 270. So basically, our goodwill will be 245. Yes, Lucky Goyal, correct. This will be the consolidation entry. So ultimately, under a step acquisition, we have to recognize gain on fair valuation of previous investment. This is called gain on fair valuation of previous investment. Guys, understood or not? Now I am discussing one more situation. Since
here it is just a 10% investment, and here we have to apply 109 on the balance sheet date. So suppose on balance sheet date this 10% was fair valued at 110,000, for example, fair valued at 110,000 in SFS it is already fair valued at 110,000. That means now on 60% is 750, and carrying amount of 10% is 110. Now it is carried at 860. Now it is carried at 860 on date of acquisition. What you will do? Tell me. I'm just changing some situation. See, practically this is the 10% investment. So basically on balance sheet date we have to make the fair valuation as per Ind AS 109. And Ind AS 109 says make it at fair value only. Suppose the fair value was 110,000. That means on balance sheet date we have passed entry for fair valuation like investment account debit to P&L 10,000. Understood or not? That means we have already recognized the 10,000 gain, in our SFS. Now tell me, what will be the change here? Please tell me what will be the change here. Tell me guys, investment to P&L 15,000, very good. Here only 15,000 will be recognized as gain, and this entry would be same, don't worry, this entry would be same. Understood guys? 15,000 will be recognized in the P&L. Yes, very good. So please tell me now, have you understood this entire scenario, step acquisition? Have you understood this situation one? Situation, I have discussed that there can be two different situations. First situation is at first time acquisition, you are not having control, but at the time of second acquisition or third acquisition or in the subsequent acquisitions, you are getting the control. Okay? Guys, clear? So have you understood this situation? Please tell me, have you understood this situation? So that I should jump to the second situation now. Shall I jump to the second situation? Second situation means this. Shall I jump to the second situation? How is the value of NCI 270? Ankit Kabra. Dear, 270 is basically 30% of net assets. 30% of net assets. Okay, I should jump to the second situation. First time acquisition 60% and second time acquisition 20%. That means at the very first time we got the control, and again after getting control again we are acquiring some
sort of another equity interest in the same subsidiary company. Ankit, have you understood how we got the NCI at 270? So, second situation. Guys, let me tell you one thing. This second situation is not called as step acquisition. It is not step acquisition. It is just called as acquiring additional shares after getting control. I must say, acquiring additional shares after getting control. But this is not step acquisition. This cannot be called as step acquisition. Guys, understood or not? This cannot be called as step acquisition. Only this is called step acquisition. Okay? Only this is called step acquisition. This is very, very simple. Okay, where it is written now? See, you have to read this entirely. Multiple acquisition or step acquisition. You have to read this point. Okay, now. After the session becomes over, you can read these points. You can read this point. Okay. Then come to here. Disposal of shares, point number B. Purchase of additional shares or disposal of shares affects NCI, but control exists. This is the point. Additional shares purchased, control already exists. This is the point. Okay, let me tell you what is this. Okay, taking another example. Example 2. Purchase of additional shares after getting control. Karan is asking from where we get the notes. Karan, when I have started session 1, if you check the recording of session 1, lecture number 1, then in the description of lecture number 1, there is a link, a Google Drive link, where I have uploaded all the notes for this business combination along with the questionnaire notes. So you can get the notes from day 1 description link. Okay. First April. This is financial year 2021. This is financial year 21-22. Okay. So here we acquired 60% investments. Guys. Understood or not? Here we acquired 60% investment at say 8 lakhs. So this 1/4/2020 becomes date of acquisition. Obviously, this will become the date of acquisition. Suppose
on 1/4/20 net asset was 11 lakh, net asset was 11 lakh, and fair value of NCI, fair value of NCI is say 4,40,000. Fair value of NCI say 4,40,000.
Okay, understood or not? So tell me the journal entry, tell me the COC working basically. Investments 8 lakh plus NCI 4,40,000, NCI 4,40,000. This is 12,40,000 minus net assets 11 lakh. Goodwill. This is the scenario. Goodwill 140. Very good. Anirudh and Vatika. Very good. Guys, all understood? Now please come here. On this date, we again acquired 20% equity interest. We again acquired 20% equity interest. At 3 lakh rupees. Say 3 lakh rupees. At this date, we acquired the equity interest at 3 lakh rupees. Guys, understood or not? We acquired the investment at 3 lakh rupees. Tell me what will be the impact. Tell me what will be the impact in the consolidated financial statements. What will be the impact in consolidated financial statements? Tell me what will be the impact in consolidated financial statements. We acquired another 20%. Earlier we have 60%. We are already consolidating the books of subsidiary with our books. We have already calculated the goodwill or gain from bargain purchase. We have already recorded the net assets. We have already recorded the NCI. Everything. So when we acquired another 20%, what would be the impact in our consolidated financial statements? Tell me what would be the impact. 20% NCI shall be derecognized. NCI will be changed. Value of NCI will change. Okay. NCI share will be reduced from 40 to 20, okay. NCI will reduce, proportionate NCI derecognize. Very good. Yes. See, our control remains the same. Because when we acquired 60% share, we already got the control of 100%. Okay. Because our control doesn't change. Our control doesn't change. Only the NCI will be changed. NCI will be reduced. Yes, NCI will be reduced. Your answer is correct. NCI will be reduced. Now, another question, how much? Another question, how much? How much NCI? NCI shall be derecognized and goodwill and gain from bargain purchase will be calculated again. Anirudh Goyal, let me clear you. There will be no impact on goodwill or gain from bargain purchase. Once the goodwill or gain from bargain purchase is calculated, there will be no impact. There will be no impact on goodwill or gain from bargain purchase. No effect on goodwill or gain from bargain purchase. So first of all, let me clear you one thing. NCI will be reduced. Yes, okay, very good. Goodwill or gain from bargain purchase will never be affected. Once it is calculated earlier on the date of investment, on the date of acquisition, done. No need to change. No need to change. Goodwill, once calculated on the date of acquisition, it will not be changed until and unless it is being impaired. Until and unless it is being impaired. Okay? NCA shall be derecognized. 220. Okay, sir. 220. 3 lakh. Whether we should consider gain on fair valuation of previous investment? No, we should not consider the gain on fair value of previous investment. No. Anas, no. NCI will reduce and our investment will increase. No effect on goodwill. Okay. Tell me how much NCI will be reduced. 220. How much? 220. Your 220 answer is wrong. 220 is wrong. NCI will reduce by 3 lakh. Okay. NCI will reduce by 3 lakh. NCI will be reduced by 3 lakh. Achha. How the 3 lakh has come? Ankit Kabra and Kajal Gupta. How the 3 lakh has come? Shiva Kumar 14667. How you guys are calculating these values? Please tell me how you guys are calculating these values. 3 lakh, taking the fair value on 17. Okay. Taking the fair value on 17. Okay. That means if 3 lakh is for 20%, that means 100% would be 15 lakhs. And the NCA would be 40%, like 6 lakh. Okay. Because NCA should be at fair value. Okay. Okay. See. Okay. Understood. There can be two scenarios. Either question will give you the figures of net asset and NCI on 17 means 21. Either question will give you the figures of NCI, that means what is the existing figure of NCI on the date of 17, they will give you the carrying amount. That is carrying amount. So if the question is giving you the carrying amount of NCI, for example, net asset on 17, say net asset on 1/7. Say 19 lakhs. They have given you the net asset value 19 lakhs. They have given you the net asset value as 19 lakh. For example, if the net asset value is given to you, if the net asset value is given to you at 19 lakhs, guys, understood or not? Net asset value is given at 19 lakh. So obviously, therefore, NCI at 40% should be 19 lakh into 40%, that is 760. Guys, understood or not? NCI should be at 760 carrying amount in CFS. Sir, why in CFS? Obviously, NCI always show under CFS only. And since we are preparing CFS from the last year only, because in the last year we got 60% shares, so we are preparing CFS in the last year only. So in the current year also, we already have the carrying value. In the current year only, we have the carrying value of NCI, because we are preparing the CFS from last year. So NCI 40% is carried at 760, obviously, for the obvious reason, if we consider proportion of net asset method. Guys, understood or not? Okay, and if this is the case, now NCI shall be reduced by 20%, that is 760 divided by 2. 760 divided by 2. NCI shall be reduced by 380. Guys, tell me please, have you understood this point? NCI will be given, or net asset will be given, and you will be in a position to calculate the NCI always. They will give you the net asset figure on 1/7, so you will be in a position to calculate the NCI definitely, and NCI will be reduced by 380. Now tell me the journal entry, what will be the impact on CFS? NCI will be reduced, okay, so what will be the impact on CFS? Since holding company acquired 20% investments at 3 lakh, under SFS definitely the entry must be investment account debit 3 lakh to bank, and under CFS this investment will be reversed. And entry will be NCI account debit 380 to investment 3 lakh to OCI. That means fair value gain, and this fair value gain will be charged to OCI as 80,000. Guys, this impact will be given here. This is the case of CFS. We are assuming that we have already passed the entry under SFS as investment account debit to bank. So under CFS, this investment would be reversed. Obviously, it is for the obvious reason that under CFS, no investments are carried. We carry the net assets of subsidiary, we carry the NCI, we carry the goodwill. So this investment will be reversed at 3 lakh only. Okay. NCI will be reversed by 20% impact, that is 3,80,000, and the difference will be charged to OCI. Whether it is a debit difference or credit difference, it will always be transferred to OCI. This entry will be passed. Kajal Gupta, wrong entry. NCI 380 to cash 380. How the cash becomes 380, guys? Why gain in OCI? Okay, why gain in OCI? I'll give you the reason. Let me give you the reason. But before that, I just want to ask, have you understood this point or not? Have you understood this entry or not? Okay, see guys, there's a difference between these two situations. Step acquisition. And acquiring additional shares after getting control. There's a difference between these two situations. What is the difference between these two? Situation 1, that is step acquisition. On subsequent acquisition, control is affected. That means what? At the time of first acquisition, we don't have control. At the time of second acquisition, we got the control. That means the control becomes affected. At the time of first acquisition, control was not with us. Control was with anyone else. But at the time of second investment, we got the control. So control has been transferred from one party to another party. Understood or not? Control has been transferred from one party to another party. But in situation two, try to understand. In Susan, I will explain the entry, okay? Sir, why in OCI, why not in profit? I am explaining the same point. In situation 2, control is not getting affected subsequently. Here, on subsequent acquisition, control was affected. But control is not getting affected subsequently. How? Let me explain. At the time of first acquisition only, you got the control 60%. At the time of second acquisition of 20%, control is itself with you only. Control is still with you only. So at the time of second acquisition, control is already with you, na? There is no such impact, actual impact in your books. By acquiring another investment, you should not be happy, because you are already happy since you have already got the control in the last year. So control was not affected. So it is not the actual gain to be recognized in the P&L. See, gain in P&L and gain in OCI, there's a big difference. Gain in P&L means actually it is the kind of gain which is a kind of realized gain. But when the control is not getting affected, it is already with you. By acquiring another 20%, 30%, control was already with you. It is just, see, control is not affected, net assets are not affected. One, control is not affected.
ऑलरेडी विद अस, नेट असेट्स नॉट अफेक्टेड.
सर हाउ द नेट असेट्स आर नॉट अफेक्टेड? बिकॉज वी आर ऑलरेडी रिकॉर्डिंग 100% नेट असेट्स.
ऑलरेडी रिकॉर्डिंग 100% नेट असेट्स.
सो नॉट, नो कंट्रोल इज अफेक्टेड, नो नेट असेट्स आर अफेक्टेड.
देयरफॉर गेन शुड बी ट्रांसफर टू ओसीआई.
वी कैन नॉट कॉल इट एज अ रियलाइज्ड गेन. वी कैन नॉट कॉल इट एज अ रियलाइज्ड गेन एंड दिस इज द रीजन वी शुड ट्रांसफर टू ओसीआई. बट अंडर स्टेप एक्विजिशन योर कंट्रोल वॉज अफेक्टेड एंड हेंस इन दैट फर्स्ट सिचुएशन वी मेक द फेयर वैल्यूएशन ऑफ प्रीवियस इक्विटी एंड वॉट एवर द डिफरेंस दैट डिफरेंस इज ट्रांसफर टू पीएनएल बिकॉज योर कंट्रोल वॉज अफेक्टेड. अंडरस्टूड और नॉट? सो दिस इज द रीजन अंडर दीज टू सिचुएशंस. अंडर सिचुएशन वन स्टेप एक्विजिशन गेन फेयर वैल्यूएशन गेन ऑफ प्रीवियस इन्वेस्टमेंट शैल बी ट्रांसफर टू पीएनएल. बट अंडर सिचुएशन टू यू ऑलरेडी हैव गॉट द कंट्रोल. You already carrying your net assets of subsidiary at 100% only. There is just a change of NCI. So difference between NCI and the bank account, that means NCI and the value of 20% investment will be transferred to OCI because it is not your actual gain. You already having control in that company. Anu Bansal, sir, why in OCI? Why not in P&L? I have explained. Susan, can you please explain the entry once more? Okay, I'll explain. Deepu John, sir, why not taken directly 20% of 190? We can take it directly also. Don't worry, Deepu. We can take it directly also. 190 of 20%. Don't worry. We can take it also. Susan Matthew, Susan is saying, sir, can you please explain the entry once again? What was the entry, sir? See, in SFS, you have made the entry investment account debit to bank. Obviously, investment account debit to bank because you have acquired the investment 20%. But while preparing CFS, obviously the investment will be derecognized. NCI derecognize. Generally we used to credit the NCI net assets account debit to NCI. Why? When the NCI is being credited, it is being increased. When the NCI is being debited, it is being decreased. So here it is decreased. Okay, and whatever the difference is transferred to OCI. So guys, have you understand the logic between these two situations? Please tell me. Under a step acquisition, there is a kind of actual gain because the control is being affected. Earlier we don't have control, now we got the control, it is our actual profit. But under situation 2, we already got the control, we are already recognizing the net assets, we are already having the 100% net assets. There is no such impact on our net assets, on our goodwill, on our control. Only just the NCI is being affected. Understood or not? So this is not your profit which is to be recognized through P&L. NCI is the item of statement of changes in equity. See NCI, where you show your NCI? NCI is the item of SOCI. Okay, and you are derecognizing the investment. See here, investment, it is your capital asset. Okay, and NCI, it is an item of SOCI. So whatever difference will be there, you have to transfer directly to the SOCI. Okay, I think I have explained you properly and you guys have understood the point. So now let me revise this point once again. there are two different situations under multiple acquisitions. Under multiple acquisitions, there can be two different situations. Situation number one, step acquisition. Under a step acquisition, at the time of first time acquisition, you are not getting the control. At the time of subsequent acquisition, like in the second acquisition or the third or the fourth, in the subsequent acquisition, you are getting the control. Suppose you are getting the control at the time of third acquisition. At the time of third acquisition. So on the third acquisition, the previous two investments, that is first and second one, the previous two investments shall be fair valued first, shall be fair valued first, and whatever gain or loss will be there, it will be transferred to the P&L only, P&L of holding company. Understood? And normally we pass the entry for consolidation, like recognition of net assets, recognition of NCI, recognition of goodwill, gain from bargain purchase, derecognition of net investments. But in situation 2, at the time of first acquisition only, at the time of first acquisition only, we got the control. That means at the same time, we calculate our net assets, we calculate our goodwill, capital capital reserve, that means gain from bargain purchase, and NCI. At the time of second acquisition, we acquire another shares. We acquire another shares. So control is not being affected, therefore goodwill or gain from bargain purchase should not be recalculated, should not be recalculated. Okay, net assets is not being affected because we are already carrying the net assets of subsidiary in our books because we already got the control previously. Understood? So only the NCI will be reduced. When the NCI will be reduced, it is to be debited. Okay, and whatever the difference will be there, such difference will be transferred to OCI. I think this was the proper explanation you have got from my side. Okay. Read this point. Read this point. NCI account debit, pro rata adjustment. What do you mean by pro rata adjustment, sir? Pro rata is like NCI was 40% at 760. Now NCI becomes 20%. So how much it should be? It is called pro rata. To cash, sir, why we are crediting cash account? We should credit the investment now. I am assuming that I am making direct entry without debiting investment. I am making direct entry. So I am assuming that I am making direct entry without making investment as debit. For, see, there are two different ways. First, either you should debit the investment to investment account, debit to cash, and then credit the same investment account in this entry, or don't pass the first entry, directly pass the second entry, so to cash, and the difference in above entry is directly transferred to other equity. Other equity, difference will be transferred to other equity. Guys, please answer me, is it clear or not? 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 Okay, you can practice this question, question number 107. You can practice this question, question number 107. It is your homework. If possible, we will discuss this question in the next class. Okay, if possible, we will discuss this question in the next class. You can practice this question. Understood or not? You can practice this question. Anirudh Goyal, sir, break for 10 minutes. Actually, Anirudh, there is a problem. I have to end this session today in just 15 to 20 minutes. Sorry guys, but I have to end this session in just 15 to 20 minutes because I got a message from my WhatsApp society group that electricity, they are shutting down the electricity temporarily for few hours today. So there is a kind of some maintenance work. So because of the maintenance work, we got the WhatsApp message from our society that electricity will be gone by 10 o'clock or 10:15 o'clock. So I have to end up this session in just 15 to 20 minutes because there is some maintenance work is going on. So sorry for that. Okay, so homework 107. Okay. This was basically what? Multiple acquisition. This was multiple acquisition. Okay. Now I am discussing one more point. Unrealized profit loss on assets is stock transferred within the group. Unrealized profit loss on assets or stock transferred within the group. Stock transferred within the group. Tell me guys, shall I start? Tell me. Don't worry, in just 20 minutes we will cover up this. In just 20 minutes we will cover up this. Tell me. Okay, shall I start? Unrealized profit loss on assets, stocks transferred within the group. Ekta Gupta, sir, you said there can be two cases. How to reduce NCI? Yes, I forget that. How much? Either question will be given, will give you. Okay, if question won't give you any figure of net asset or NCI on 1/7, then take 3 lakh as a base. What is this 3 lakh? 3 lakh is this. 3 lakh. That means investment 20% as a base. Take 3 lakh as a base. If this would be the case, then NCI would be reduced by, tell me how much amount? NCA would be reduced by how much amount? Obviously 3 lakh. NCA would be reduced by 3 lakh only. Then entry would be NCI account debit 3 lakh to investments 3 lakh. No OCI effect. no OCI effect. Okay. Ekta, thank you for reminding. Okay, guys. Unrealized profit loss on assets transferred, stock transferred within the group. Elimination of unrealized profit / loss on stocks can you explain again Ekta the point is if the question will not give you any figure as on 1/7 of the net assets or NCI then what will you do obviously we don't have any other option then in that case we assume that the NCI will be reduced by fair value only now what is the fair value you have acquired 20% investments from the market at 3 lakh and this must be by default the fair value if the 20% is 3 lakh and NCI is 40% the NCI is definitely at 6 lakh fair value So NCI is at 6 lakh fair value at 40%. You have to reduce the NCI by 20% proportionately. Then it will be reduced by 3 lakh. So we have to assume that NCI shall be reduced by fair value. Okay. Now, come to this. I have to discuss this in any case. In just 15 to 20 minutes so please guys listen to this guys there can be two cases case 1 case 2 case 1 case 2 downstream transaction what do you mean by downstream transaction holding company sold goods to subsidiary company and there can be upstream transaction that means subsidiary sold goods to holding company subsidiary sold goods to holding company there can be two cases sir how to identify the downstream and upstream how to differentiate between downstream and upstream sir downstream see holding company and subsidiary company obviously holding company is a big company a large company so it is the definitely a big company a large company and it is a small company so holding company is at top and subsidiary company is at bottom so downstream downstream understood or not so holding sold goods to subsidiary downstream now again holding which is at top subsidiary which is at bottom subsidiary sold to holding upstream subsidiary is going to the holding company for sale subsidiary is going to holding company for sale it is upstream okay it is upstream and it is downstream in this way you can differentiate between these two upstream and downstream upstream and downstream. Okay. Now, what is the golden rule? Golden rule. For both cases, the company who sold, the company who sold the goods has definitely earned the profit. The company who sold the goods has definitely earned the profits. For example, in downstream, who sold the goods? Holding company sold the goods. Definitely holding has earned the profit, and the profit earned by holding company is being shown under the reserves and surplus of holding company. Therefore, the company who earned the profit shall eliminate the same. Now, how this golden rule will be applied? Again, this is case one. Downstream. Case one, downstream. Holding sold goods costing 1 lakh to subsidiary after date of acquisition at 1,20,000. On balance sheet date, subsidiary has still unsold goods from above of rupees 60,000. See, the heading is on unsold stock. Okay. Holding sold the goods costing rupees 1 lakh to subsidiary company. Okay. So tell me, SFS of holding, SFS of subsidiary, holding has passed entry, bank account debit, either bank account debit or subsidiary account debit to sales account 120, and here purchase debit to bank or holding 120. Tell me, this is the entry. Now, on balance sheet of subsidiary company, there is unsold stock of 60,000 with subsidiary. Obviously, purchased from holding. Unsold stock of 60. Now, try to understand. Obviously, this stock will be a part of net asset on consolidation. Obviously, this will be a part of net asset on consolidation. So, in CFS, what shall be the entry? In CFS, what shall be the entry? See, this stock has been shown at 60,000 in the books of subsidiary company, that's fine. But when we consolidate this stock of 60,000, when we consolidate this stock as a part of net assets in the books of parent company, we have to eliminate the profit element. We have to eliminate the profit element included in this 60,000. Because this 60,000 was actually sold by holding company only. Now again this 60,000 is being shown by holding company in its CFS. So holding company cannot show this stock at the sale price, because holding company knows very well the stock should be at cost. Holding company knows very well that its cost is obviously the less than 60,000. Guys, understood or not? Understood or not? So this is the reason we pass entry to stock account 10,000, and reserves and surplus, that means other equity of holding company. Other company of holding. This entry would be passed. Sir, why other equity? Other equity means reserves and surplus, because holding has earned the profit in this sale. See, the sale is booked at 120. The sale is booked at 120. That definitely the 20,000 will be the net profit, and net profit is transferred to the retained earnings of other retained earnings under the other equity. So you have to debit the retained earnings basically. Other equity matlab retained earning. Tell me guys, have you understood this? Tell me guys, have you understood this point or not? This was downstream. What was the golden rule? The company who earned the profit shall eliminate the same. Here, holding company earned the profit. So holding company will eliminate from its own reserves and surplus. From its own reserves, from its own equity. Understood or not? Please guys, tell me, have you understood this point, so that I should continue with the second case. Sir, how this 10,000 arise? Simply, if the cost is 1 lakh and total sale is 120, out of which 60,000 are still unsold, that means the proportionate profit will be 10,000. So have you understood this point? Case 1. Now let me explain the case 2. Upstream. Subsidiary sold after date of acquisition to holding cost 1 lakh at 120. On balance sheet date, unsold stock with holding is 60,000. Understood, guys? So tell me, how much profit earned and recognized by subsidiary, that is 20,000, out of which 10,000 is realized and 10,000 is unrealized on unsold stock. I am saying this unrealized from entire groups point of view, because holding and subsidiary are part of same group. So holding has sold to subsidiary has sold to holding company, but holding company has not yet resold to the third party. The unsold goods are still with holding company by rupees 60,000. So it becomes the 10,000 of profit which is earned by subsidiary company becomes the unrealized profit from the group's point of view. Understood? So we need to eliminate this profit. Obviously we need to eliminate this profit under CFS. We need to eliminate this profit under CFS. So how to eliminate? Check the golden rule. Who has earned the profit? Now the subsidiary has earned the profit. So who will eliminate? Subsidiary has to eliminate. Tell me how the profit shall be eliminated. I am waiting for your answer. For your reply. Please tell me how we shall eliminate this 10,000 unrealized profit under CFS. How shall we eliminate? How to eliminate this CFS? How to eliminate this 10,000 from CFS? Tell me. Guys, I'm waiting for your reply, please. From the net assets of subsidiary. Rupanand says from the net assets of subsidiary. Okay, this is the one effect. What should be the second effect? Anisha, a portion. Paresh, from consolidated P&L and NCI in their proportion. Eliminate from parent company profit. Akhil, wrong. Eliminate from parent company profit, no. Subsidiaries share reduced from NCI holding share from other equity. Good. Very good. Very good. Very good. Very good. Paresh, Deepu, Ankit Kabra, Anisha. Very good. See, can I say when we prepare statement of changes in net assets, there are actually three columns. One is date of acquisition, one is change column, and one is balance sheet date column. And what do you mean by change column? Change column is basically the revenue profit of subsidiary, and this is the transaction which is done after date of acquisition. So obviously under this column that profit of 20,000 has been included under this column. Can I say this? The profit of 20,000, overall 20,000 profit has been included under the revenue profit of subsidiary. So basically after time adjustment, once you have made the time adjustment, you need to eliminate the unrealized profit. You need to eliminate the unrealized profit from this change column. And when you are eliminating from change column, technically the answer of change column will be reduced by 10,000. And it is apportioned between parent and NCI. So technically the 10,000 will have impact on parent's P&L and NCI's share. Parent's share, NCI's share. So technically the entry should be other equity of parent 8,000 I am assuming 80% share. NCI 2000, 20% share. Two stock, 10,000 share. And if you don't want to make this entry, because obviously the institute will not ask you the entry. Institute will not ask you the entry. Institute will ask you the long question. So try to understand here only that under long question, you just need to write unrealized profit in this change column. So please tell me, have you understood the impact of change column? Under change column only, we will eliminate the unrealized profit, but after time adjustment. Sir, why after time adjustment? See, we make the time adjustment for normal profit after taxes. See, this 10,000 is also part of normal profit. So once the time adjustment has been done, then only you can eliminate the profit from change column. Sir, why always change column? Because we sold the goods after date of acquisition. So it is a post acquisition transaction. Sir, what if when it is a pre-acquisition transaction? Guys, very good news. All the pre-acquisition transactions between holding and subsidiary, pre-acquisition transactions, before the date of acquisition transition, you need to ignore this. No need to eliminate any kind of profit or loss, any kind of unrealized profit in case of pre-acquisition transactions. So we are just considering the post-acquisition transactions. So now tell me, have you understood the point? And so that we should conclude this session finally. Have you understood this point or not? So that we can conclude the session. Tell me guys, so that we can conclude the session, have you understood the point? Have you understood the point or not? Ekta Gupta, I have explained you, if the goods were sold before date of acquisition, will the treatment differ? There will be no treatment. Ignored. Understood. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Ekta, give me the reply. If the same transaction occurs before the date of acquisition, you have to ignore it. Whether it is downstream, whether it is upstream. You have to ignore it totally. No need to eliminate any kind of profit. Understood or not? Because the transaction occurs before date of acquisition, we have to ignore it. Okay, I think you all have understood. So finally, we are ending up the session because what we have discussed today, our target was to discuss the unrealized profit, to discuss the multiple acquisition. We have done this. Disposal of share, this is pending. Not an issue, this is not a big point. We will discuss it in the next session, don't worry. Sir, how many sessions will be there? There will be on an average 6 sessions. One small request, sir, if possible, kindly upload the board notes, sir, so that we can update our notes after the lecture if missed any important. Guys, Ankit, this cannot be done because I write all this in OneNote. OneNote is a separate application. So converting OneNote from OneNote to PDF is a long approach, and this will become a file in GBs, basically. This will become a heavy file in GBs. So providing that file will not be possible for me. So I just recommend you that after the session becomes over, you can once again watch the session just to write everything. I'm not saying that watch the session entirely. In the mid of the session where you want to write, you can write it. So, okay. So guys, thank you so much for this. And finally, we have concluded today's session of day 4. We will meet on another day. I will tell you the day, probably day after tomorrow. Probably on day after tomorrow, I will definitely meet you for day 5 session. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, guys. Next session will be day after tomorrow. okay. So next session will be day after tomorrow, that means on 14th morning. Okay, so thank you so much. Bye bye. Jai Mata Di. Allah Hafiz.